the marginalization of the most vulnerable women, and as a social movement, the feminism should also be accountable for those women and not be the ones who actually pressurizes these women into making the wrong choices. All right. The opening half mainly talked about choice. This debate isn't about choice, right? They were debating about whether or not the feminist movement should support housewives or not. This is about using that choice as a metric of empowerment. Now let's take a definition check. What is metric? Metric is a standard of measuring or evaluating something, right? Meaning the fact that this is whether or not saying that making a lot of choices is empowering and whether or not being passive is not empowering, right? This is a totally like different debate. Goodbye, opening opposition. Okay. to go on to engagement to the opening and the opposition, right? So to clarify from government side, we are all for respecting all women's choices. But what's happening right now is the metric of empowerment is saying you being passive means that you are less empowered than people who are making lots of independent choices, who are going out there into the workforce and saying, like, for example, speaking out about their rape cases, right? We think that, first of all, this is a false and oppressive dichotomy. It's not true to the fact that you saying nothing is the same thing as you being powerful, right? Oftentimes, you not making a choice and you not saying anything is the strongest thing that you can do. We first of all reject that dichotomy and reject that metric to begin with, right? But we think that no thank you. This debate is not about respecting choice or choice feminism, but it's about, to go on to the two abstentions coming from closing up opposition. Go ahead.
So are you for or against women just making choices that may not be for the feminist movement or not aligned with the goals of the feminist movement? Just yes or no?
I'm not going to answer yes or no. But like, we think that what's going on right now is the fact that women are being forced to take choices just for the fact that they should be taking choices. What we're against is that. So we're going to talk about that in my point. First of all, we think that the women who are allowed to make choices and who have the options of making choices in our society are the wealthy and privileged women, right? It is only when you are affluent, it is only when you are rich, it's only when you have the money and time and that options and opportunities open up for you. It's only when you have university degrees that you can have a whole spectrum of different choices, right? However, we think that most poor women, especially women in developing countries, don't have that many choices, don't have the option of not being a housewife because there's no choice for them, right? We think that what that does essentially, by saying that this is the metric, it crowds out the needs and the empowerment of those poor and vulnerable women who need that empowerment and marginalizes them. I only take one POI. So, but for example, right, we think like, for example, the like microcredits in the developing countries. When the idea of microcredits was given in the developing countries that became wildly popular, where women can borrow money for a business, it made women force them to go into work, to force them to get those microcredits because of the fact that that was an open choice then. Now, that looks superficially very empowering, right? But what actually happened is the fact that these developing countries' women were not able to escape their household duties that they were forced to do, and because of that, were forced to do both their household duties, and then in like the few hours that they had left, to go to work, to create their own business, to go in, to go into that workforce, right? We think that what happened because of that is that instead of empowering those women, it made those women more miserable. It hurt them more. It actually de-empowered them, and hurt them in a massive way. We think that that is extremely harmful because of the fact that, first of all, it marginalized those women, right? Now, why is it important that marginalizing people especially harmful for the feminist movement? This is the principal argument that opening opposition wanted so badly, right? It's because of the fact that for all social movements, and especially for feminism, the goal of feminism is to defend the most vulnerable and the most marginalized within our society and give them their needs and give them their empowerment, right? What this does is that you actually go against those vulnerable women who need your help, who don't have any choices, and who need your empowerment. We think that that is wrong, and feminism should not stand for that. But secondly, we think the option not making a choice is the best choice that you can make, right? We think that, and in this way, we think in a broad spectrum, it actually hurts hurt for working women out of the developed countries as well, right? Because when you say that making a choice, making those independent choices, is what's best for you and what empowers you, what that does is that it pressurizes women into making choices just for the sake of making choices and feeling like they are empowered, right? We think that, first of all, it's false to say that it's like making a choice is the best choice. Now, let's take an example, right? Sometimes what the feminist movement does in order to make you have a choice is that when you are offered like a job position or a CEO position, they pressurize you into making that choice because it empowers you more, right? However, we think that women are just as justified to say no to that position if it empowers you and if it gives you, for example, a better life. It helps you have a work-life balance that is much better for you, helps you spend more time with your family, right? But furthermore, things like not speaking out about domestic violence, not speaking out about rape, what this metric of empowerment does is that it forces these women to go into these uncomfortable positions in order to feel empowered. But sometimes, not speaking about things that hurt you and what happened to you can often be the best choice for these women. Meaning the fact that this is harmful because feminism is there to empower women and to make their lives as best as possible, to make it best for them, right? We don't think that what they are doing right now with this hierarchy is the fact that you are actually making them make more choices, forcing them to make more choices, forcing them into what the patriarchy has been doing for all of these generations and generations. We think instead what feminism should be doing is respecting these women, not making choices, but furthermore respecting these vulnerable women in society who need our help, who don't have choices open to them, but are equally empowered as women in developed worlds who have all these open options open up to them with their university degrees. At the end of the day, this has nothing to do with, for example, choice feminism as opposition side. We wanted to frame it. We hope closing off the shift takes a different debate. Very happy to go.